Good evening, hello, and welcome to People and Politics, a special programme which comes tonight from Bonn. Special because tonight, Willy Brandt has agreed to give us his first major television interview since he resigned last May as Chancellor of West Germany. Herr Brandt has been a lifelong member of the SPD, the German Social Democratic Party. He spent most of the last war in Norway, where he learnt to speak Norwegian as well as you find he speaks English. He wrote and underground pamphlets and organized the movement against the Nazis. 3 years ago, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize for relaxing East-West tensions by the treaties he had signed with Poland and Russia. Today, Willy Brandt is still a member of the Bundestag, the West German Parliament, and is the chairman of the German Social Democratic Party. He is still, as ever, an ardent European. Herr Brandt, a long time ago, I suppose it seems now, when you were on the run for the Nazis and organizing underground movements and writing underground pamphlets, did you ever believe that you would achieve so much as I have just recited?
Well, when I left Germany in 1933, I was only 19 years old, and I expected then one day I might be editor of my party's local paper in my hometown of Lübeck, and perhaps also a member of parliament. I moved a little bit beyond that.
You did indeed. When exactly did your political ambition take shape?
In a way, I was born into political interest.
You didn't have much choice in Germany in the 30s.
Even when I was at school, I was interested in politics. And then, of course, when you take your decision at such an early point of your life and you are confronted with that kind of a challenge that we were confronted with when Hitler took power, you concentrate all your interest, I at least did, if possible, to contribute to a better future for your own people and by that for Europe as a whole.
You made a choice, and you made a socialist choice. Many people, of course, in Germany didn't make the same choice. Good people, I suppose. Were you never at all tempted, never at all seduced by Hitler in any way?
No, I was not.
Why?
Why should I? Hitler, for me, represented something hostile to human values in which I believed when from I was very young. I was much more radical when I was young, that's so, but my belief in basic human values has not been changed, and I thought he was very much against the interests of normal people, and I think I also understood very early that what he represented was another war.
Now, you are still, Herr Brandt, in political terms, a young man. Do you not feel at all that you are now, to some extent, left out? You're a man, as it were, condemned to stand on the sidelines of the game of politics, not in the midst of the game.
You see, I'm responsible, under our kind of a system, for a large party. It's the largest party in Germany, as far as members are concerned. Votes, if we take the last national elections, I think that will be the case again when we have a new national election. In any case, this is a large party. We combined for a certain time the office of party chairman with that of the chancellor. When I resigned, we decided to divide the two responsibilities. So I have a good deal to work on.
With respect, Herr Brandt, it's not the same thing as holding the chains of office, is it? Do you not miss that, regret that decision?
No, I do not. If I had ambitions in power in the narrow sense, these ambitions I discovered are not the Well, the last point you reach. There are other things to work on and to concentrate your interest upon. No, I have enough to do, and I keep in contact with some of my European colleagues, follow international development, and perhaps here and there I can influence them even without occupying the office of Chancellor.
We'll look at your influence in those respects in a moment. But if I may just stay with a resignation for a moment, why on earth did you give it all up? You didn't have to, did you?
It was a mixture of two elements. One was that I thought, and I still believe, I had to take personal responsibility because I followed an advice which I later on thought was a wrong advice. When I was warned that the man could be a spy, the advice was given that he still should remain around me, almost a year before he finally was, was discovered.
Yes. Or exposed.
Exposed. I think I should not have followed that advice, but I had followed it. And I think I had to take the responsibility. But there was another element. Had I stayed in office then, early in May, this would have caused so much controversy, so much political quarrels, that I would not have had time enough to concentrate upon these major problems with which we are faced in Germany, as we are faced with them in all our countries nowadays: economic problems, problems of inflation and employment and whatnot. So I thought, and I still think, it was the right thing to transfer that office to a new man. That's what I did when I proposed that Helmut Schmidt should be elected chancellor, and I could concentrate upon other kind of responsibilities.
Did you fall or were you pushed?
No, I made my own decision.
Without outside influences?
I made my own decision.
May I just put one other point to you before I leave this question? It has been said that, in fact, the Watergate affair in America influenced you enormously, and that in some ways you made a personal decision to resign, almost as it were, to show that politicians in the West could do this.
No. I've seen a good deal of comments along that line, especially in the American press. No, the conditions were so different here in Germany from those in the United States, and I would rather not give anyone the impression as if by taking a certain decision myself I would criticize anyone else.
I turn to the common market now. What is it in your own experience and your own past that makes you such an ardent marketeer?
Not necessarily an ardent marketeer. Common market is a rational thing, a reasonable thing. Experience has shown, even if we have difficulties nowadays, that it makes sense to have a large market without all these old-fashioned trade barriers. And it did pay, by the way, for those countries which participated in it. My country's great economic development, good economic development, to a certain degree at least, to a high degree, has to do with this large West European common market. I mean, if we look at the figures, trade between France and Germany can be compared with what it was before. Both countries have become their number first trade partners, which they never were before. No, but this was not the not where I started. I started during the war and said, together with many others, but I said, as a result of what I read and what I experienced, that that we must look so Europe Western Europe, in any case, and if possible, even beyond the barriers of boundaries of Western Europe, we must bring together that kind of union or federation or whatever may be the structure of it, which could not only take care of common economic interests, but which also could make it sure that Europe, with all it still has to give to the world, can play a role in world affairs and just would not consist of a number of medium-sized countries pushed around by dominating world powers.
Chancellor Schmidt told the Labour Party conference last week, your comrades in Europe want you to stay in. Why? With our economic state, we can hardly be a great asset to the market at the moment that way. We spend a great deal of time when we come to the market wrangling to have the rules changed. The nation, as you know, is split on the very principle of the market. Why on earth do you want us in?
Let me first say that I totally agree with what Chancellor Schmidt said when he was in London. When this process of West European unification started very early in the 50s, Schumann, Adenauer, De Gasperi of Italy, the coal and steel community, and later on the common market, Federal Republic of Germany, France, Italy, and the Benelux. Many of us in Germany, and Helmut Schmidt and I belong to those in Germany, believed that Europe already was split as a result, divided as a result of the East-West conflict. We had what Churchill called the Iron Curtain, even if it doesn't play the same role as it did a few years after the end of World War II. But we have that split between the East and the West. And we believed that it would be good not to have an additional division and an additional split in Western Europe. Then many of us believed and still believe, in spite of all the difficulties many of our friends have nowadays, we believe that Britain has something to contribute. We want to have a close relationship with Britain because of the tradition of British democracy.
Do you really mean that? I mean, you always say that. What's so special about our democracy that will be useful for Europe?
You see, for us who have gone through the experience of Nazism, as we dealt with at the beginning with this program, or other countries, other systems totalitarian rule, we have always looked upon, and still do, looked upon Britain as a country with deep-rooted parliamentary and democratic traditions. We also believed and still believe that Britain has collected experiences in world affairs which should be made part of a common European heritage and not just remain with the British since the Commonwealth or the empire first, and the Commonwealth has changed into a new structure. Having said this, we never believed that we could say more than, you are welcome. We would like to see you within a West European community. But nobody should have the impression as if we wanted to interfere.
Can you manage without us?
Of course we can.
How do you interpret Mr. Wilson's visit to France this week?
Oh, I think that was a very wise decision to make. It's always so important if you prepare for a summit meeting, if the German Chancellor, as we say.
What do you think he told the French President? What do you think he was saying?
He had contact with the French President before he had contact with the British Prime Minister, and it was only reasonable then that there also should have been a personal contact between your Prime Minister and the French President, just a kind of equilibrium in the preparation of such a summit meeting.
You don't think Mr. Wilson was assuring the French President that the Germans and the English weren't ganging up on them?
No, I do not think that there is such a fear in Paris, but I think it will help for the discussions they're going to have in Paris next week.
Do you detect a change in the attitude of the British government leadership over the market? Do you feel them becoming gradually more pro-market?
I've had very little personal contact during these last few months, so I have to base my judgment upon papers. And if I look upon proposals made by our British colleagues and friends and compare that with what has been discussed within the councils of the community, I think things are moving in a direction where a positive answer could be given upon most of what I would call the legitimate British demands or proposals in connection with a future membership within the community.
Are you now convinced that we are in fact arguing positively, that we are arguing to secure arrangements to stay within and not merely find an excuse to get out?
I'm in no position to give a reasonable answer upon that. All I can say is that we and our colleagues here in Germany, I think this is true for others as well, will be as cooperative as possible. And then our British friends will have to find the answer. We can't give an answer instead of them on their behalf.
You were a socialist, as you said, much more radical in your youth, like most people were. Yet, and this, the Social Democratic Party is to some extent the equivalent of our Labour Party. When I look at Germany, I don't see a socialist society. I see a very materialistic society. What's socialist about it?
We are only at the beginning of a long road, but you see, our philosophy of social democracy, of course, does not correspond with what our fathers and our grandfathers believed in. German socialism believed in, or German socialists 100 years ago, and perhaps even 50 years ago, thought that socialism stood for personal, individual freedom, of course, and justice, but at the same time was more or less identical with a transformation of privately owned enterprises into state-owned enterprises. We came to the result when we looked upon our own experience and looked upon state capitalism in Eastern Europe and looked upon our experience with fascism, that we were not enthusiastic anymore about transforming factories and business into state-owned enterprises, risking that bureaucracy might play a much larger role than we think it should play. So we are not, this is one of our main differences with traditional socialism. We do not concentrate so very much upon the problem of ownership.
This is very much a key figure, if I may say so, Herr Brandt, in Labour Party policy, of course, as you know, nationalisation and ownership. Is this because the Labour Party, like the rest of Britain, lives in the past and lives in the age of the grandfathers?
No. We have, of course, each of us has a tradition of his own. We do not exclude exclude enterprises owned by the state. Of course, we have state-owned railways and power stations and whatnot. But we do not think that this is a key problem of socialist orientation. This is a question of what is wise to do. There are areas where it is necessary to give more influence to the state than before, but we believe in a kind of mixed economy, and where private ownership is replaced by something else, we believe in cooperative organization, yeah. High degree of participation of the workers. But as I said, we do not think that socialism is the same thing as transforming factories into state-owned enterprises.
I'll take a break in a moment, but if socialism isn't that, what is it? And what is your, what is the older Willy Brandt's philosophy?
Yes, socialism, democratic socialism, means to transform as much as possible of democratic principles from the political scene into economic and social spheres of our life. By other words, to transfer the basic values of justice and solidarity into these economic and social areas without identifying oneself with one formula, one dogmatic formula in organizing things.
Herr Brandt, before I move on to other matters, can I return to the market for a moment? Can I get clear what you're saying about Britain, that you want us in because of our democracy, because of our traditions, and because of our a general sort of rather indefinable sense of what we offer the world, but you can economically, Europe can really do without us?
Economically, it would also be a great advantage. I think it will be an advantage for Britain.
For Britain?
For Britain. But it will also then be an advantage for the whole of the community, because that larger market will be to the benefit of the expansion of our economies. That I still believe.
But not fundamental to the future of the, to the economic future of the market.
The market is not dependent upon British membership, no. But the market could fail even without British membership. But it has existed for a number of years with a considerable success. But it is now confronted with all these new problems of energy and worldwide inflation and whatnot. So quite apart from the problem of British membership, the community is faced with great dangers.
What are those dangers? I mean, you really say it could fail. I mean, the whole thing could fall apart.
I do not hope, and I do not really believe it could disappear or fall apart, but it can be reduced to much less than it already has been, at least much less than it could become.
Principally because of the energy crisis?
Yes.
The energy crisis is obviously is something that one sees that the Germans in particular are paying attention to. Do you see any way out of it, any way in which one is not for a long, long time, as it were, beholden to the Arabs and that they call the piper all the time?
We cannot change the new terms, of course, from one year to another, but I think that in serious negotiations between the industrialized countries, developing countries, and oil countries, we can work out some terms which are more favorable to us than those which we have to follow now. And we can do more in the field of substitution and a number of measures which make us less dependent upon oil than we are now.
Do you want Britain in the market because of our oil lying off the North Sea?
I've been a member of, I've been very much in favour of British membership long before I knew that there would be oil outside of your shores.
Do you think the goal of political union by 1980 can possibly be achieved?
80 or 85, and then, of course, it very much belongs upon what you call political union.
That's what I'd like to hear from you. Do you have any... I mean, I asked Mr. Callaghan what he thought it meant, and he said he didn't know. Do you know what it means?
I do not care too much, you see. I've followed with great interest all these struggles between various schools, the Federalists who think they should have one European federal state, and others who call more of a federation of states, Europe of the peoples, or Europe of the fatherlands, les patries, as de Gaulle put it when he was in power. No, I think the essential thing is to agree upon those responsibilities which will remain with the individual states. This union of Western Europe will not become another kind of United States of America, and it should not. It should be composed by these independent cultures and structures, but they will have to agree upon those areas where they develop common responsibilities with common structures of government. And that would have to include at least a considerable part of foreign policy in the sense of taking care of our common interests in this changing world.
You know how deeply suspicious the British are of giving up anything of their sovereignty, of course.
Yes, and I understand that, but as I see it, it's not a problem of giving up sovereignty, but it's a problem of taking care of your sovereignty and ours in a way where we still could agree upon transferring a certain part of it into a new structure of common sovereignties.
If the market fails, what happens to Europe? To the nations of Europe?
I think if we, if those who then follow us regain the strength we failed, they may find it possible to take a new start. But it also could speed up the process of reducing Europe much more and making it much more than even now a group of countries which really do not have much to say in further international developments.
Turn to Ostpolitik now. Ostpolitik, I should say. Are you happy about the way that policy has developed? Your political opponents in Germany, of course, call it a failure. Are you happy?
How could I be happy? But I think my opponents really are wrong. What we did, see, Ostpolitik meant to normalize our relations with the Soviet Union and the East European countries without endangering our relations with our friends in the West. And we developed that process, so we reached that kind of relations with the East our Western friends had before. This enabled us to take care of our own interests in the East, and all the time in close contact with our friends in the West. By doing so, we also contributed a little bit to the overall development of East-West relations. The serious talks between the American and the Russians on things like strategic weapons and so on would have been postponed had we not in 1970 made our treaty, our agreement with the Soviet Union. It would have postponed things. It would not have upheld things. So this is the third element. Had we waited much longer than we did, we would have faced the danger of isolation because the new relationship between the superpowers, in any case, would have become one of the dominating trends of world politics.
You said right at the start, how can I be happy? What makes you unhappy about it?
I would, of course, have hoped that we already would have reached more in the field of improvement for normal people. You see, what does let's take the Soviet Union. We have much better political relations between the governments. We have some more trade, some more technical, scientific exchange. That's the case with other countries as well. But with East Germany, which remains our most difficult partner, of course, within the Eastern Bloc, we have not reached enough in the field of making it possible for people to meet, to visit each other. It's much better than 3 years ago. Traffic to and from Berlin is much better than 3 years ago. But I would like to see more exchange in the cultural field, sports, family visits, because there are so many divided families in this divided country. With Poland as well,
May I stay for a minute, sir?
Yes.
I mean, you say East Germany. I mean, the key thing is that the wall is still there, isn't it? The wall, this scar, I think you once called it, runs through Berlin still. Is that a permanent feature of life now in the modern world? Will it ever go?
There is no isolated answer to the wall in Berlin, as there is no isolated answer to the division of Germany. The division of Germany is a reproduction of the division of Europe. And Berlin, again, is an addition within the addition. So only if and when major changes will take place, overall changes between West and East, these inhuman consequences of division, like the wall, eventually could disappear.
When you look at the West and East, what was once called the Cold War, certainly no longer a Cold War, Khrushchev once said in relation to the West, we will bury you. Do you think that is no longer the Soviets' aim? Has communism changed fundamentally in that respect?
No. Communist leaders, even what I would call the conservative communist leaders, believe, and I think they have to believe, in the final victory of what they think is a kind of law, a kind of necessary development of society. But I've experienced that they haven't been always right in what they think is a result of their theories.
You think they're prepared to, as it were, to let the historical process take its normal process without war? Do you think they've
yes.
given up that arm of their?
Yes. I think they are prepared to face the possibilities and necessities of peaceful coexistence and cooperation. But there are always areas in the world where things are much more difficult than they are in Europe, even more difficult than in Europe, and there still the risk of war can disappear, but not necessarily as a result of communist governments wanting to expand communism, but because there is another danger of being or engaging oneself or being engaged in power political quarrels.
They presumably believe that capitalism, the West, will dig its own grave. Do you see a danger of, in fact, capitalism and the West obliging them and digging its own grave?
What is capitalism nowadays? In any case, it's not the kind of capitalism Karl Marx was describing when he worked in London on his large volumes of Das Kapital and communism, as far as I can see, is not just the same kind of system Lenin described when he worked on his theories. So we are in a process of great changes between both of the, within both of these systems.
Suppose what I'm really asking is whether the ideological struggle is still paramount or whether it's really become an economic struggle.
There still is a good deal alive of the ideological struggle, or the struggle between systems of very different political orders. Then there is an economic struggle, but we should never forget that some of these problems upon which we concentrated when we spoke of the Cold War have been overshadowed by new problems in the world, and especially those problems which have created a new kind of controversy with the countries of the North and those of the South. I think this already now, in many respects, is overshadowing the East-West conflict.
Well, the problem of the underdeveloped nations, yes, and of the haves and the have-nots.
Yes.
There are many who today fear for our way of life, who write about it, who believe that democratic systems of which you were talking so much are a very fragile flower. Do you believe that? Do you believe democracy to be a fragile flower?
No. But I think there will be a need during the years ahead to look into the effectiveness of our democratic machinery. Just to give you an example, I remember several years ago when I talked to the Swedish Prime Minister or to the President of Finland, and they would tell me, you must on the continent introduce the British system of electing parliaments, the majority system instead of the proportional system, always leading to the danger of getting many, many parties into a parliament and thus weakening the effectiveness of the system. Nowadays, we, with our proportional system, only have three parties in parliament. You still have three and some smaller ones in your parliament, but even the majority system doesn't lead to very clear majorities as it did before. The Scandinavian countries, with all their strong and solid democratic background, are in all kind of troubles electing people into parliament who just do not want to pay taxes. How does like it, by the way? But they collect a great number of votes. We have the crisis of democracy in some southern European countries. At the same time, we have a new awakening of democratic activities in countries like Greece and in Portugal. But as I said, the machineries, the concrete machinery of the democratic process have been developed at times when it was much easier to run a country, when economic problems played a very minor role than they do today, for example. So I think this will be something to think about and work on.
There's an impatience with the system, isn't there? There's an impatience with the democratic system, and that impatience seems to lead to an intolerance then, especially among the young, you know, whose radical ambitions seem to lead them far more than perhaps in your day to want to smash everything in sight.
Yes, but they haven't found an alternative. They haven't found an alternative. Many of them believe in replacing parliamentary democracy by some kind of councils, various professions and whatnot. Experience has shown me that that is no alternative.
You're an optimist for the human condition? A moderate one. What does that mean?
I think there's hope, but I think there are great dangers, and they demand a good deal of energy to counteract developments which could be very bad for mankind. But men always, even if they are, or especially if they are faced with challenges and great dangers, they have the chance and then the possibility not only to find a way out, but to replace existing conditions by better ones.
10 years from now, I mean, what do you think will be the face of Europe, the problem of Europe? What will be occupying our minds?
Well, I hope very much. I cannot really tell you what will be the situation. I'm thinking about what could be possible, and I think we could have a higher degree of not only cooperation, but belonging together, and we could also have made further progress in what I would call the all-European process. I mean, those areas where we can have, in spite of the differences of political systems and ideologies, where we can have cooperation within the between the West and the East, and including the neutral and non-aligned countries of Europe.
Do we have to sell out the state of Israel in order to solve the energy crisis?
No, we should never do so. And as a German, I think pay even more attention to that than others have to. Well, perhaps except the British, who, in a way, made it possible for Israel, as a result of declarations made during World War I, to start first for their community, which then was transformed into a state by a decision of the United Nations. But with all our terrible background of, as a result of an inhuman German system with so many Jewish victims in the world, for me it's just unthinkable to accept anything which would threaten the right to live and the right to exist within guaranteed borders for the state of Israel.
How do you then solve the energy crisis? How do you convince the Arabs of that is the problem, isn't it?
Yes. Well, my experience still as a chancellor was that there should be an area for a reconciliation with between reasonable moderate Arab leaders and the leaders of Israel, assisted on both sides by those who carry responsibilities for world or peace in the world.
Can I come full circle back to yourself? How much do you think your entire attitude to politics and your attitude to life has been conditioned by the awful experience of the war in the 30s and by the guilt which you take upon yourself for the German people?
I can never run away from this past, and I never wanted to run away from that. But personally, I have been as much influenced by what I experienced in the Scandinavian countries where I lived when I was young. That was a long period, first in Norway, then during most of the war in Sweden. So I have been much influenced by the way in which they are thinking and how they developed their societies. And I think my German friends at least know that I introduced some of that experience and that thinking into my activities here in my own country and within my own party.
Are you too good to be a politician?
No, I don't think so.
Sometimes said that this, isn't it? It's sort of like criticism made that you wear your heart on your sleeve, that you trust people too much. Do you trust people too much?
Could be. But this is, I think, in the long run, it is better than to run away all the time being suspicious of against those you have to do with. If you make the balance of it, I think it's better to take a view which is more influenced by confidence than by mistrust.
Isn't though mistrust almost the essential condition of the successful politician?
Yes, but it should not become a dominating factor.
When you came to writing out your letter of resignation, did you feel that you had been betrayed?
No, I mean, the spy affair, which you mentioned before, was no surprise. What really did hurt me was, or what made a great impression upon me, was that someone could give you the impression to be something very different from what he really was. This was a very strong impression made upon me. No, as I said before, I had to take the responsibility also for decisions made by others for a rather unfortunate
Should some
episode.
Of the others not have resigned?
No, I didn't ask anyone to resign.
Should they not have done?
No, I think it was good enough that one did it in a way for the case as such, in putting all factors together.
When you look back on your political life, what will you say has been your greatest achievement?
That perhaps is too early, and I do not know if I'm the right man to answer that question, but if I have been able to contribute to my fellow countrymen, my country, my nation, becoming more of a good neighbor in Europe than they have been before, I think this would be a good thing.
And your failure?
I would rather have others to, I have, some, there would be so many to mention, so.
You're being over modest.
A little bit too difficult to pick up one and expose it.
If not your failure, something that when you laid down the reins of chancellorship that you had left unfinished and of necessity can't now finish?
No, the things I started can be followed up, and I think I still will be in a position to participate in this process of following up our policy of not only safeguarding but organizing peace, and our policy of making this country more of an organic democratic organization, and our policy of bringing Europe forward in the direction of a factor which influences the world in a positive way.
Do you believe your political career in government terms to be over?
In the sense of the narrow sense of government, not in the American sense of government, because in the American sense of government, what is done in Parliament belongs to that.
You know what I mean. Government executive.
No, when I left office, I made it clear that I have no ambition to have a comeback, so to say. I rely upon that. The other responsibilities I can take care of will give me that kind of ground upon which I can work, which will be good enough.
I've heard suggestions that you might consider jobs outside Germany, the United Nations Secretariat, things like that. Does anything like that interest you?
No. There have been questions here and there. But you see, I will be 61 in a few weeks from now. I do not have so many years ahead of me of active political life, and I think I should use these years for active work, responsible work for German social democracy. I will take part in some European and international activities, but not as a main responsibility.
Herr Brandt, thank you very much. That's all we have time for tonight. Thank you for such a fascinating look at the world.